हेलो गाइस, दिस इज अदिप. वेलकम टू माय चैनल मूवमेंट साइंस, वेयर आई सिंप्लीफाई बायोमैकेनिक्स एंड आल्सो लॉट ऑफ ऑर्थो टॉपिक्स विद जो. सो इफ यू आर न्यू टू दिस चैनल, कंसीडर सब्सक्राइबिंग. आल्सो चेक मी आउट ऑन इंस्टाग्राम, वेयर आई पोस्ट डेली एमसीक्यूज एंड आल्सो पिक्चर्स ऑफ माय नोट्स. द रेफरेंस टाइम फॉर ऑल द टॉपिक्स दैट आई एम गोइंग टू कवर विल बी मेंशन डाउन इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन, सो चेक दैट आउट एंड लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड. In this video, we are going to talk about the dynamic stabilization of shoulder joint. The last video was about the static stabilization. So if you haven't checked that out, do check it out. I'll link it in the description. And also I'll link the series, whole shoulder series that I've covered till now. So let's start with the topic. So if you look at all this, you might get too intimidated because there are so many divisions and so many points under it. But I can assure you that at the end of the video, you'll know all the functions of each muscle, what they have role to play in the dynamic stabilization of your shoulder joint. So basically, the dynamic stabilization to your shoulder is provided by different muscles. And over here, the important part is all the structures are active structures. That is, they are contractile structures. So that is your deltoid muscle. So first, when they looked at deltoid, they were like, okay, deltoid must be causing all the movement at shoulder joint and providing it the stability. But then they realized, not really. So over here I mentioned deltoid muscle cannot work independently, right? So they realized deltoid cannot independently give the stability to your shoulder joint. So then they came to the obvious rotator cuffs, which do provide a lot of stability, and they combined with the deltoid can give a good mobility with stability to your shoulder. So deltoid plus your ITS, that is the infraspinatus, teres minor and subscapularis, they provide a good stability, that is they keep your humerus in the right place and carry out the movement. And then they also looked at the supraspinatus, which is a part of the rotator cuff, but it had a different angle of pull. And then we'll finally go to the biceps tendon and we'll see how it provides the stability. So let's start with the deltoid first. So deltoid has three parts, that is the anterior, middle and posterior deltoid, and all these three vectors can be combined into a single deltoid vector, that is the pull deltoid has on the humerus. So let's look at that. So this is the pull that deltoid has on your humerus, and this is the diagram you might need to draw during your exams. So the deltoid is the FD, right? The force deltoid has is the FD. And then when we resolve the vector into two components, that is a parallel component and a perpendicular component, that is this component is parallel to your humerus, right? And the perpendicular component is perpendicular to your humerus. So it has a very big parallel component. So FX is the very high superior translatory force on the humerus, which is parallel. And then FY, this is the FY, which is a reduced force, but it is a perpendicular force on the humerus bone. Right? Simple till now. So now let's look at these vectors and see what it does in your glenohumeral joint. So in deltoid, we saw that there is a posterior part, then there is the anterior part and then lateral part, right? So what were the forces that we saw under deltoid? The humerus was being pulled superiorly. There was a very big superior component to your humerus, and then some slight amount of abduction component, right, outward. So your deltoid basically comes like this, holds your humerus and then superiorly pulls it, and then abduction occurs. So this is the movement of your deltoid. Now we saw that the superior component was very big, right? And to counteract this superior component, we need a force that offsets this force. Now you would say that this force is provided by your coracoacromial arch, right? So if you see, this is your scapula and this over here is the coracoacromial arch. So when it is present over here, the humerus is blocked by your coracoacromial arch, and that's how it's stopped superiorly, and then abduction occurs. Now you might say that, but we all know that when the coracoacromial arch is present over here and the superiorly translating humerus goes up, it will impinge the structures over here, that is the supraspinatus tendon coming from top and also the biceps tendon, right? So this cannot help your offsetting of your superior forces of your deltoid. Offset also means compensating the extra superior forces of your deltoid. So other force might be your gravity, right? Gravity is pulling your humerus downward and the deltoid is pulling it upward. So this will be balanced and then abduction can occur. But not really. Why? This is because when your abduction is occurring, your deltoid is already defeating your gravity, right? The gravity is not allowing your humerus to go up, right? Or go for abduction. So this is defeated, the purpose of gravity is defeated by your deltoid muscle, and it is letting your humerus go upward. So the gravity cannot defeat your deltoid in compensating or offsetting the superior forces of your deltoid, right? So this brings us to a conclusion that neither your gravity or the coracoacromial arch helps you in offsetting or compensating the excess superior forces placed by the deltoid, which means that deltoid cannot work independently to control or to cause abduction of your arm. You need other muscles to stabilize your shoulder joint. Mostly the superior forces that are present on your humerus need to be offset or compensated by some other muscles to carry out the abduction at the shoulder joint. So what did we see? We saw that deltoid is a prime mover, and then we saw the coracoacromial arch can offset your superior forces, but what will happen? There will be impingement of the structures. So then we came to the gravity. Gravity cannot offset because it is overcome by your deltoid already while doing the elevation. So hence gravity is also not the one which offsets your superior forces. So that's how we know that deltoid muscle cannot work independently. So then they went to the rotator cuff muscles. Now what are the rotator cuff muscles? That is the sits muscle, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor and subscapularis. These three muscles, that is supraspinatus, infraspinatus and teres minor, are on the posterior aspect, whereas subscapularis is on the anterior aspect. So the sits muscle, that is the SITS, they are in close relation with your capsule of your shoulder joint, right? And this is a very important point because in throwing athletes, this capsule can get taut, and it has lot of related pathologies. Do note that these small points are what matters during a rehab. So I'll tell you about an experience that I had. So I was watching a podcast where there was discussion among the surgeons regarding rehab of your shoulder joint, and where they talked about the exact same points, like how your rotator cuff is in close contact with your capsule of the shoulder joint, right? And how it influences all these things. So I realized that these small facts that they provide us when we are reading these basic books are of key importance. And what happens is when we know these small facts, and then we come across some another concept, and that's how we make connections and these big concepts are formed. So my job over here with this YouTube channel is to provide you guys the concept that I have formed so that you can build further upon it and get a whole rounded experience of biomechanics. So let's go ahead with this. So these rotator cuffs are also called as the steerers because there are some rotator cuffs on the posterior side, that is your supraspinatus, infraspinatus and the teres minor, and subscapularis is on the anterior side. So when they contract, they cause external and internal rotation and provide anteroposterior stability. I'll talk about this again. So that's why they are called as the steerers. So now let's come to the main part, that is the again force couple. In all these divisions, we'll be talking about the force couple, which is the key importance over here. So if you look at the force couple of your rotator cuff, the ITS part has a downward pull on your humerus, whereas the supraspinatus has an upward pull. So that is the SITS. These all muscles have an inward pull together, but supraspinatus is more of superior pull, whereas infraspinatus, teres minor and subscapularis has a downward pull. So let's take all these three vectors, we'll combine them into a one vector and resolve it. So if you look at the vectors at the shoulder joint, this is your fx component, this is your fy component, which is the rotatory component, this is the downward force, and this is the original force that we saw, right? So let's look at this. So talking about the rotator cuff, this is your supraspinatus muscle, this is your infraspinatus, that is above the spine and below the spine, and then there is the teres minor, there is also the teres major, but that is not considered under the rotator cuff muscles, right? So there is SIT and then another S, that is your subscapularis muscle. So subscapularis muscle will be on the anterior side. So if this is your scapula like this, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor, major, which is not a part of this, and then this is your subscapularis muscle, which is on the anterior side. So if you look at the direction of infraspinatus and the teres minor muscles, this is your humerus, right? the posterior aspect of the humerus. So they pull the humerus in inward direction towards your glenoid. There is a glenoid over here, right? This. So it pulls your head of the humerus towards the glenoid. So that is the force of action. And they cause also external rotation of your humerus. The muscles on the posterior side, they cause external rotation. Whereas on the anterior side, that is the subscapularis, it causes internal rotation. So also we saw that the force was inward, right? So when we resolve the vector, the first one goes in this direction and the second one goes inferiorly. So this inferior force helps your deltoid. The superior force of your deltoid is compensated by your teres minor, infraspinatus and the subscapularis, that is the ITS part of your rotator cuff. They provide you the inferior directing force to offset or to compensate the superior force of the deltoid. And deltoid along with your ITS, that is the infraspinatus, teres minor and subscapularis, carries out the movement, that is the abduction movement, without excessive superior translation. So if you look at the subscapularis, which is on the anterior side, and the infraspinatus muscle, which is on the posterior side, both of them, what they do is they carry out the external and internal rotation of your head of the humerus. And what they do is they prevent anterior-posterior translation. That is, excessive anterior and posterior translation of your humeral head is prevented by these muscles. Another point I would like to mention is the teres minor was seen as a weak adductor muscle, whereas subscapularis was seen as an internal rotator. So how do they activate during an abduction movement? So when they checked that out, they saw that they had diminished activity during elevation movement, right? So these muscles had a diminished activity during elevation of your shoulder joint. So we have covered all the points, that is the sits, steers, it compresses your head into the glenoid fossa. Then we also saw how FX components helps the deltoid. And then the medial and lateral rotatory force, how they provide the anterior and posterior stability. Now let's move on to the supraspinatus. So the supraspinatus has a more of superior pull, and let's look at its force couples. So supraspinatus, if you see, it has a superior pull. So this is your FX component and this is your FY component, which is inward and this is upward, right? So let's look at this. So when you come to the supraspinatus muscle, the force couple of the supraspinatus was it is pulling your humerus upward like this. So the resolved vectors were this way and the upward one, right? So the upward force does not help your deltoid, right? Because deltoid also has an upward force. So it does not help your deltoid to offset your superior forces. But what it does is it is placed higher up. So it has a larger moment arm. So what it does is it is very efficient at its work. It produces large amount of torque to carry out the movement at your arm, that is abduction movement, right? So this abduction movement can be provided by your supraspinatus itself. It does not really require your deltoid muscle, although deltoid helps him do the work, but still supraspinatus is very strong. It can provide a lot of torque because of the larger movement arm, because of its placement, that is superior placement. So as we saw, the superior pull, the stability is very high due to the high rotatory component. It is placed superiorly, so it has a higher moment arm. It can produce more torque and full abduction can be carried out. And also another point is optimal balance in gravity and supraspinatus helps you keep your humerus in place. This force and counterbalance of your gravity helps the supraspinatus keep your humerus in place. And now finally coming to the biceps tendon. So this is your humerus, this is the greater and this is the lesser tubercle, and the bicipital groove is formed over here. So your biceps tendon passes right between them, and on top it is covered by your transverse ligament, which keeps your biceps tendon in place, right? So if you take Joe and if you see, the biceps tendon comes from here like this and attaches on top of your glenoid, right, to your shoulder joint. So what will it provide? When the biceps is in front, it will cause flexion. It will help in flexion movement. Whereas if you externally rotate, your biceps will be at a comparatively outer side. So it will also help in abduction movement, right? It will also provide the anterior stability because it is connected to your humerus and then it is on the anterior side going connecting to your shoulder joint. So when your humerus is pulled anteriorly, so in this direction, your biceps will block it, right? It will block and it won't let excessive movement of the humerus anteriorly. Also, it will prevent it from displacing superiorly and inferiorly, because again it is attached to your humerus and then attached to your shoulder joint. So if something is pulling your humerus down, the bicep will prevent it downward, and also superior also it will prevent. The biceps tendon will also transmit forces to your glenohumeral ligaments. So these are the glenohumeral ligaments, right? So if you can see, the biceps has a similar attachment, like it is in the similar place to your other glenohumeral ligaments, and also it is placed very near to your rotator interval capsule. So all the forces on the biceps tendon will be transmitted to your ligaments, that is the superior and the middle. So the superior glenohumeral ligament is somewhere over here, and also the middle glenohumeral ligament. So both these ligaments take up some of the force that is placed on the biceps tendon. Over here, this is a transverse ligament, by the way. And also the biceps tendon is covered with a tendon sheath over here. That is the sheath you can see. Two more points that they found to confirm that biceps does stabilize your shoulder joint was, when there was an injury to your labrum, it did not affect the stability of the glenohumeral joint. So labrum is somewhere over here, right? Like this. So when your labrum was injured, your glenohumeral stability wasn't affected that much. But when this glenoid labrum along with the tendon was injured, that is biceps tendon goes and attaches to a superior part of your labrum, right? So when the biceps tendon was also affected along with glenohumeral labrum, they saw a major stability at your shoulder joint. And the second was, they saw hypertrophy of your biceps tendon when there were damage to your rotator cuff muscles. So rotator cuff muscles coming from anterior and posterior side, which provide the stability, right? So when they were injured, what happened? The biceps tendon took over, and biceps tendon was trying to do their job of stabilizing your shoulder joint. And this is why it meant for a hypertrophy, that is increase in the width of your biceps tendon. So should you tear all your rotator cuffs just to get a bigger biceps? I would say that's a bad idea. So with that, let's wrap up the topic. We talked about the dynamic stabilization, where we first looked at the deltoid, which had an excessive superior pull on your humerus. So then we saw the rotator cuff, which helped the deltoid to counterbalance this superior force through the F component, that is the FX component that offsetted your deltoid. And also the ITS muscles, they pulled your humerus inward. Then we saw supraspinatus, how it was pulling it upward. And then we went to biceps tendon, which helped in stabilizing your shoulder joint in different directions, that is anterior stability, superior, inferior stability, and transmitting the forces. So what do you need to remember in this? You first need to remember all the three force couples, the diagram of all the three muscles, that is the deltoid, then ITS, and then the supraspinatus. Then you need to remember, deltoid cannot do it independently, so you come to rotator cuff. Rotator cuff does help, but supraspinatus has a different side to it, that is a superior part, and it has a high moment arm which helps in carrying out abduction. Whole abduction movement can be carried out because of the supraspinatus. And then you come to biceps tendon, which also has a very important role to play because of all the different direction stability, right? So with that, we'll end this topic. That's all for today, guys. Thank you for watching. If you like my content, please share it with your friends, and don't forget to hit that like button and some comments so that I can get some feedback regarding what other topics I can make. Also, don't forget to hit that subscribe button, and see you soon in the next video.